السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد، Welcome back to جنة and جهنم. Tonight إن شاء الله تبارك وتعالى will continue our discussion and our study of the description of الجنة. The description of الجنة. If you guys remember the last thing we talked about الجنة, we spoke about the rivers. And we said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentioned different kind of rivers. And even he mentioned specific description of these rivers. Of the most beautiful rivers that we heard about and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to us was in Surah Muhammad. You guys remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in one single ayah, he mentioned four kinds of rivers. Can you tell me what are these rivers? What were the four rivers that Allah mentioned in Surah Muhammad in one single ayah? What are they? Yes. Honey, flowing honey, what else? Milk. Number three?
Water.
Not coffee.
Wine,
and the last one, he mentioned it.
Water,
fresh water. So fresh water that doesn't change, doesn't get stagnant, always running and flowing. Fresh milk that never gets spoiled. Honey that is always flowing, and also the wine that doesn't cause any intoxication, which means it's a very fresh kind of wine that you will enjoy the delight of drinking it without the side effects of the dunya wine. So this is part of the anhar, the rivers of al-Jannah. Another form of water that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned al-Jannah is the springs, water springs as well. You see, when it comes to al-Jannah, I mean, usually people when we talk about al-Jannah, we always think of what? We always think of the green, lush flowers, trees, gardens, and then definitely, absolutely water. Without water or lakes or rivers flowing and water streams and so on, it wouldn't sound like Jannah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, speaking of gardens and Jannah, He mentioned already to us the different kind of rivers. But now some of the water doesn't flow or run as the rivers. These are what we call them uyun in the Arabic language. Al-ayn. Ayn in the Arabic language means the eye and also means the water spring. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in al-Jannah, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ. That indeed the righteous will be within gardens and springs. Remember the mixture between gardens and springs. Without the springs, these gardens don't look like Jannat. And Jannat without springs, water streams and springs, wouldn't also sound like Jannah or Paradise. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala making this combination. Usually, how the land gets becomes green. What's the source of this whole lush and green yani side? What would it be? Water, there's no doubt about it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about the source of life for this garden, which is the water, meaning Allah says this water is abundance. إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ. They're going to always be in gardens and there will always be water springs. So there is no fear of losing supplies. There is no fear of drought in al-Jannah, because people in al-Jannah will always have the access to this beautiful source of water. These Jannat, they come in different kinds and different styles. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فيهما عينان تجريان. Another ayah he said, فيهما عينان نضاختان. In Surah Al-Rahman, Allah Azza wa Jal described two categories of Jannat. Two categories of Jannat. Speak about two levels of paradise. So in the highest level, in some of the higher level, let's say, the higher level in paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فيهما عينان تجريان. These gardens, they have springs flowing. How come a spring flows, Jama'ah? What does that exactly mean? How would it look like? Springs that are flowing, what does it mean? Have you ever been in a site where you have water springs? Have you ever seen them? Anyone been there, Jama'ah? I've seen it in many, many areas, in Europe and different places as well. Water springs, usually, you see the water pumps sometimes, and it stays in its place. It's just pumping in that area, but it stays in place. It's still fresh. You know why? Because the water is still running and moving up and down in the same space. So that's one fancy and it's subhanAllah sight to see. And there are springs that flowing and gushing out of the mountains sometimes. So they come out of the mountain and you can see the source where it begins. And you can easily put your hand down there and subhanAllah receive some of the best, most organic, the cool, beautiful, tasty subhanAllah water. You just cup your hands and you drink this water. Imam al-Qurtubi rahimahullah ta'ala in his tafsir, speaking about some of the most halal things. Because one of the most halal things a believer can ever taste in this dunya is by cupping your hands under a water stream that is naturally created from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you say Bismillah and you drink. Because your hands are the creation of Allah azza wa jal, and this water is the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Putting them together, this is all halal and halal, and you drink it. So subhanAllah, imagine you will have the two kinds of water springs in Al-Jannah. The first category, Allah says, tajriyan, running. So the water is gushing out and it's running all over the place. Some of the, in the books of tafsir, there were mentioned some narrations that the believers will be able even to control the path of these water springs. You know, if you have been even in a farm, and if you know exactly farming, subhanAllah, sometimes the farmers, they make so much effort in controlling the water path, so that making sure that the water goes all over the place, so the plants and it grows, of course, equally and together. Now, as a believer, if Allah gave you the opportunity to make this control, to control that path, it's one of these luxuries in Al-Jannah. Because in dunya, it's a lot of work. You have to dig the canal for it, you have to make sure that block it here and there. And in Al-Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, tajriyan, and again, tajriyan by your order and command as a believer. When you're there, you can just move it and go wherever that you, it goes wherever you want that water actually to go. The other two categories of Al-Jannah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about in Surah Al-Rahman, He said, فِيهِمَا عَيْنَانِ نَضَّاخَتَانِ. These two lower levels of Jannat and Paradise, He says, نَضَّاخَتَانِ, which means the water is just spouting and just gushing. It doesn't run. Now you tell me, which is more beautiful as a sight? To see gushing water or a water that comes out from the mountains and it's running down there? What would it be? The flowing water. There is no doubt about it. When you see the flowing water, you could hear even the sound of the water as it runs. It's a natural music that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in the symphony of this universe by the creation of Allah azza wa jal. So you hear the water, you can feel it, and subhanAllah, it's just an amazing, amazing sight, amazing sound as well. So Allah is describing these uyun. Some of them will be running, some will be just spouting and just gushing in the same spot. Now, some of these uyuns, and like uyun al-dunya, when you go and you drink that water, how does it taste, jama'ah? It tastes fresh water. Imagine if you have water streams that has special flavors and tastes. Like you go somewhere and you find, mashallah, not just running water. You find running water that has a special flavor. What is the most, you know, popular flavors in Ramadan, jama'ah, for you guys here in Ramadan? Ruhafza, right? Imagine you go to a water stream and it's not pink, it's still water. But when you drink it, subhanAllah, reminds you of Ramadan. It says, wow, the beautiful taste of Ruhafza. Imagine that. I remember one time in the Hajj, we were visiting the camp of Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala. A group of us from students of Medina. So when we finished the visit to the camp of Shaykh Al-Uthaymeen in Mina, on the way out, we were thirsty. So we went to stop to take a drink. You know, there in the camps of Mina, people, they just put all these containers and big containers eventually for the Hujjaj to come and drink water to quench their thirst and so on, as Jani Sabid. So we came by one of those huge containers and we said, Bismillah, let's go and drink. We go there and we grab some cups. As we grab the cup and we just pour the water, a huge container, subhanAllah, and we're thirsty, it's hot, and it's Mina during the Hajj. We're pouring the water down there. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, this is yellow. Yellow and look, yellow and orange color. What is this? We thought it was dirty water, really. But then you look at it, wow, it smells nice. You drink it, that was actually the very famous drink, Tang. If you know what Tang is. Just like Kool-Aid, basically. And the huge container made of that, subhanAllah, that was a moment from Jannah for us being in Al-Hajj. When you are so thirsty, tired, exhausted, and just want to drink whatever. And here you go, instead of just water, sweet water. So you have it just there for free. We start drinking and drinking, subhanAllah, until we quenched our thirst completely. We definitely made dua for those people, whoever they were. Says, may Allah subhanAllah bless them, jazakumullah khair, and we moved on. Imagine Al-Jannah. You don't have containers like these. No, you have water stream. And these streams, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He will mix them with different flavors for the abrar and for the muttaqeen. He says, إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ يَشْرَبُونَ مِنْ كَأْسٍ كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا كَافُورًا. Indeed, the righteous will drink from a cup whose mixture is of kafur. Usually in the Arabic language, whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the word ka's, which means cup, here it means ka's, cup, it means actually crystal cup. And crystal cup usually is used for what? For wine. Therefore, if the word cup was mentioned as or in the Arabic word kas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about wine. So he says over here, إِنَّ الْأَبْرَارَ يَشْرَبُونَ مِنْ كَأْسٍ كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا كَافُورًا, that the righteous will be drinking from these crystal cups, of course, and from crystals, basically, and mixed with kafur. So the drink is mixed with kafur. Imagine you have water streams, all of this, giving you all these beautiful tastes and beautiful flavors. Another spring in paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the believers, يُسْقَوْنَ مِنْ رَحِيقٍ مَخْتُومٍ, they will be given to drink pure wine which was sealed. You know, the culture of wine, alhamdulillah, I've never tried that before, but you can hear it from people. They say the older it is, the more valuable it becomes, it seems to be. Because if it was sealed for many, many years, it becomes very precious. And they serve that for very special occasion for special people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making this remark for the believers in Al-Jannah, that this has been aged, this has been prepared, sealed for the believers. خِتَامُهُ مِسْك, sealed with musk. Even the seal itself, because you know when you seal that, when you seal the grape or wine for so long, it starts giving that bad odor or smell. Allah says, no, the seal is musk. Just the smell, when you open it, smells musk. Means beautiful. It doesn't smell any kind of bad any smell or odor. He said, خِتَامُهُ مِسْك وَفِي ذَلِكَ فَلْيَتَنَافَسِ الْمُتَنَافِسُونَ, and the last of it is musk, whether this is the last that you drink or the seal of it. He says, so for this, let the competitors compete. If you are interested in competition, there will you compete. Then he said, وَمِزَاجُهُ مِنْ تَسْنِيمِ, and we mix that also with tasneem. He didn't mention exactly what tasneem is, subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he said it's going to be mixed with the tasneem, عَيْنًا يَشْرَوْ بِهَا الْمُقَرَّبُونَ, a spring from which those near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will drink. So Allah mentioned to us kafur as a mixture, and then he mentions tasneem over here, and here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the word salsabila, وَيُسْقَوْنَ فِيهَا كَأْسًا كَانَ مِزَاجُهَا زَنْجَبِيلًا, and they will be given to drink a cup of wine, again because the word kas was mentioned one more time, whose mixture is of ginger, so a special flavor. عَيْنًا فِيهَا تُسَمَّى salsabila, from a fountain within paradise named salsabil. May Allah make among those who will taste the salsabila, jama'ah. The mansions of Al-Jannah, houses, the dwellings of Al-Jannah. Where would the people of Al-Jannah be living? Are they going to be living on the street? Are they going to be living anywhere? Some of us, I know for sure, we said, I'm willing to be in the streets of Jannah, never mind. I don't need anything, just get me there. And I'll be more than happy to live on the curb, ya akhi. I agree. Because the Prophet also mentioned the hadith we quoted earlier, that the mawdi'u sawti ahadikum, just the space of a sawt, which means if you have a small rope and you put it on the ground, that circle that just leaves there, it's better than all what is there on the earth, all what is there in the universe. Just having that space, small space in Al-Jannah, the value of this is more than anything that's in this universe. You know, sometimes in the dunya, it's the same thing. You go to certain cities, like they say, one of the most expensive cities in the world is actually Mecca. Therefore, if you have a small shop, a shop that it only fits you standing, and the rest of it is just shelves, you'll be a millionaire. Because there are a lot of shoppers, a lot of traffic, and people, they will buy whatever is there, subhanAllah, they will buy it. Imagine that. So the value, even though it's small, but it's actually huge. Al-Jannah is the best example. Whatever Allah subhanAllah provides for you in Al-Jannah, it's greater in value than anything there. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla is speaking not about just, you know, spaces, speaking about houses, mansions. The estates of Al-Jannah is so great. قال الله تعالى وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا وَمَسَاكِنَ طَيِّبَةً فِي جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ. He said Allah has promised the believing men and believing women gardens beneath which rivers flow, wherein they abide eternally, and pleasant dwelling in gardens of perpetual residence. مَسَاكِنَ طَيِّبَةً فِي جَنَّاتِ عَدْنٍ. So what is the description of these masakin, these houses of Al-Jannah? How do they look like? We mentioned earlier before that Allah subhanahu spoke about the structure of Al-Jannah is made from gold and silver and other things. Here's what Allah subhanahu says about these houses of Al-Jannah. Here Allah Azza named them ghurufat. He named these dwellings as ghurufat. Ghurufat like saying chambers or rooms or dwellings. He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَأُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ جَزَاءُ الضِّعْفِ بِمَا عَمِلُوا وَهُمْ فِي الْغُرُفَاتِ آمِنُونَ. And these, for them, to be the righteous ones, there will be the double reward for what they did, and they will be in the upper chambers. These are dwellings of Al-Jannah of Paradise, safe and secure. You see, what is the most essential thing about, you know, having a house? What is exactly provided for people? Security and safety, right? Even when people, they live for a long time, you know, under in rent, at some moment they want to feel more secure. So what do we want to do? They want to buy a house, right? Although here in this kind of economy, buying a house sounds beautiful as a sign of security and safety and so on, but in reality it might not be. But in Al-Jannah, Allah Azza wa Jal guarantees that for you. He says, you're going to be in these upper chambers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep you safe and secure. And you know, when you have a fancy, beautiful house, what does that exactly attract? Attract other people, right? Their eyes, and maybe also attract thieves, burglars, right? So people, even if you own a big mansion, you still need to secure it. So you pay companies to secure a house for you. You know, these safety systems, security systems, and so on. You pay them to make it safe, subhanAllah. Even if it's your house, and you're still not feeling safe until you have somebody else, a third party, to secure that house for you. Allah Azza wa Jalla in Al-Jannah, He says, no. You will be in these chambers. You'll have these dwellings and these houses, these beautiful mansions, and you will be absolutely safe. You worry about nothing. You're secure, because when it's your house, it's not going to be taken away from you. You're not going to fall in one payment, it will be taken away from you. And because it's so beautiful, it's so fancy, it's very tempting for burglars to come and you know, break in, but you always be safe, inshallah ta'ala, and secure by the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned a description of these houses. In this hadith in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he spoke about Al-Jannah, these dwellings of Al-Jannah, he says, إِنَّ فِي الْجَنَّةِ غُرَفًا. There are some dwellings in Al-Jannah. تَرَى ظُهُورَهَا مِن بُطُونِهَا وَبُطُونَهَا مِن ظُهُورِهَا. You can see the inside out, from inside and from the outside. So you might say, but how is that, how's it going to be? I mean, what about privacy? What about... Now, Al-Jannah is a different realm, of course, different world. What does that exactly mean to us in terms of beauty? But the Prophet ﷺ described that as being so beautiful. It is so beautiful, so amazing. To what level? Allahu ta'ala alam. Is transparency of these houses, that the transparent, you know, walls, and is that what it means? Allahu ta'ala alam. Then a man, a Bedouin, asked the Prophet ﷺ, Ya Rasulullah, who's going to get these beautiful houses? Means, to whom are these going to be prepared? He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لِمَنْ أَطَابَ الْكَلَامِ وَأَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامِ وَأَدَامَ الصِّيَامِ وَصَلَّى لِلَّهِ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسِ نِيَامِ. رواه الإمام الترمذي. He says in the hadith, لِمَنْ أَطَابَ الْكَلَامِ. أَطَابَ الْكَلَامِ, it means, when he speaks nicely and gently. وَأَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامِ, he gave basically food. Basically, he was generous, whether it's with the guest, with relatives, or even with the poor. وَأَدَامَ الصِّيَامِ, continuously fasting on regular basis, Mondays and Thursdays and other days of the week. وَصَلَّى لِلَّهِ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامِ, and he prays at night when everybody else is sleeping. Prays at night for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when everyone else is sleeping. So these are the qualities. If you would like to be among the people of Al-Jannah, the dwellers of these houses, beautiful chambers, you better now acquire these qualities. That when you talk nicely and beautifully. You don't say vulgar words, you don't say bad things and so on. وَأَطْعَمَ الطَّعَامِ, you feed other people. Make sure to remember other people around you, inshallah ta'ala. وَأَدَامَ الصِّيَامِ, that you fast on a regular basis. This is the winter, alhamdulillah, it's easy to fast. وَصَلَّى لِلَّهِ بِاللَّيْلِ وَالنَّاسُ نِيَامِ, and you pray for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at night. You have a short day to fast, long night, alhamdulillah, to do qiyamul layl. So enjoy the beautiful time of the winter. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us a different description of the dwellings of Al-Jannah. He says, Khiyam. The word Khiyam means tents, pavilions. You know, like I remember just until maybe last year or the year before that, when ICI, they used to have the Ramadan iftar, right? They have these beautiful big tents and pavilions. But imagine if this is prepared not just, you know, as a temporary makeshift kind of place for people to get together. Now imagine if this was designed to be something permanent, something fancy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, حُورٌ مَقْصُورَاتٌ فِي الْخِيَامِ, fair ones reserved in pavilions. Speaking about the ladies, the fair ladies of Al-Jannah, says, in pavilions in Al-Khiyam. And he described Al-Khiyam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave a very unique description of Al-Khiyam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this hadith, Jibreel came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he says, يا محمد, يا رسول الله, يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, إن الله, he said, Khadija, your wife is going to come right now. She's coming and carrying something in her hand, some food in her hand. So when she comes in, أبلغها, أبلغها من ربها السلام ومني. Let her know, let her give her the greeting of peace, the greeting of peace and salam from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a greeting of peace from me, from Jibreel. And then let her know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for her في أبيت من قصب لا صخب فيه ولا نصب. He said, let her know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for her a house in Al-Jannah made of qasab. The meaning of qasab in the original Arabic word of qasab means actually tents that are made of beautiful, beautiful fabric like silk. So when Al-Jannah is all made of silk, these tents are made from a very special, unique, you know, a fabric that is fancy, it's beautiful, it's charming, it's amazing, made of silk. And he said, لا صخب فيه ولا نصب. لا صخب فيه ولا نصب means there is no noise and there is no fatigue. So she doesn't have to worry about working anything anymore. She doesn't have to carry the food anywhere anymore. And she doesn't have to worry about kids running around and making noise. Because this is the reward that they will get in Al-Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also described al-khiyam, or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described al-khiyam that were mentioned in the Quran as al-lu'lu'a, like big pearls. And these pearls are very fancy and beautiful. So these are the dwellings of Al-Jannah. These are the houses that are made in Al-Jannah for the believers. How can you acquire one of these houses? Actually, why one? Why can't you have more than one? You see, the people in dunya, people in dunya, if Allah subhanahu gives them wealth and money, what do? They would like to own places everywhere they go. The so-called celebrities and billionaires and millionaires, everywhere they go, they have a place for themselves. They can call it home. They have a mansion somewhere. They have a beach house, you know, down south in Florida. They have a nice, beautiful place in South California. They go to Europe. They have an apartment for themselves. Everywhere they go, they have a place. Imagine if you have that many houses for yourself in Al-Jannah. So everywhere you go in Al-Jannah, you have a place you can call home. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in this hadith, whoever builds a masjid for Allah, if anyone builds a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a masjid for the sake of Allah azza wa jal, he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَوْ كَمِفْحَصِ قَطَى, even if it was a nesting place, like a small space, like a nest of a bird, even if it was that size, of course you're not going to have anybody praying that in that space, but it's just an example. It doesn't mean it has to be a fancy, big, huge masjid. If you participate in a portion to build a masjid, like this one, for example. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said here, Allah will build you a house. Rasulullah said that Allah will build you a house in Al-Jannah. So every time you participate, you have a house in Al-Jannah. So whenever you hear a fundraising in this community for any masjid, don't hesitate. Don't hesitate. Give. Give as much as you can. Perhaps that what you give will be, inshallah, the secure, you know, place for yourself in Al-Jannah. Another way of getting yourself a house in Al-Jannah, in Hadith Habiba radiallahu ta'ala anha, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, whoever prays 12 extra rak'ah every day, Allah will build for him a house in Al-Jannah. من صلى ثنتي عشرة ركعة من غير كل يوم من غير الفريضة بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. Every day you pray 12 extra rak'ah besides the fard salah. The fard salah 17 rak'ah. But the sunnah, the nafil salah, that's what it means. Now the ulama, they argue, what are these 12 rak'ahs? And the vast majority, they say, these are the rawatib that you pray with the fard salah. So there is the 2 rak'ah before fajr, 4 rak'ah before duhur, 2 rak'ah after duhur, 2 rak'ah after maghrib, and 2 rak'ah after isha. You count these are 12 rak'ahs. Again, 2 rak'ah before fajr, 4 rak'ah before duhur, 2 rak'ah after duhur, 2 rak'ah after maghrib, and 2 rak'ah after isha. By the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you maintain these salawat, these rak'ahs every single day, I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you one house every time, every day you do that. Now if you can contemplate on this, now you start saying, oh my God, how many houses I have missed already? Although some of us might say, yeah, Shaykh, I've done it, alhamdulillah, one time, I'm happy with it. So I secured one apartment, alhamdulillah. Why? If you can have more and more and more from the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never ever settle with the least if you can get the highest in Al-Jannah. Al-Jannah has a beautiful, beautiful fragrance, beautiful smell. The smell of course, when you have gardens, when you have flowers and trees, when you have all the kafur, when you have all these beautiful, you know, fragrances and that comes from the water streams and springs and so on, therefore they would smell amazingly. SubhanAllah, I mean, sometimes you go here to a museum, botanical, for example, museum, and you walk down the aisle and you smell all these beautiful smell of flowers. Imagine this is multiplied for a perpetual smell, the smell of Al-Jannah. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in the hadith, whoever kills a man of Ahlul Dhimma, someone with whom has a security with the Muslim Ummah, and someone comes violate the safety of this individual and kills him. And unfortunately, many of these people in the Muslim world are being violated because of, you know, the conflict that happens over there, unfortunately. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, anyone who violates the safety and the security of this individual and kills them after they've been secure under the words, the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, لَمْ يَرِحْ رَائِحَةَ الْجَنَّةِ. This person who kills a dhimmi will never get to smell the fragrance of al-jannah. وَإِنَّ رَائِحَتَهَا لَتَبْلُغُ مَسِيرَةِ كَذَا وَكَذَا. While the fragrance of al-jannah can be experienced from a distance of 40 years traveling. 40 years traveling, imagine someone 40 years traveling, that's how many miles in space even? How many hundreds and thousands of miles in space even, subhanAllah. Still, Al-Jannah, that smell can be experienced from that far distance. And someone who violates the safety of any dhimmi, anyone who's non-Muslim living under the Muslim safety and security, is indeed, you know, jeopardizing his safety in Al-Jannah, or for Al-Jannah. As Allah, the Prophet says, Allah will distance him far away from Al-Jannah. Al-Jannah has beautiful trees and fruits. Beautiful trees and beautiful fruits. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the trees and the fruits of Al-Jannah. You know, one thing about the fruits of Al-Dunya, let's talk about the fruits of Al-Dunya. One of the most perhaps annoying things about the fruits of Al-Dunya, that some of them, actually they don't exist any all around the year. Like for example, watermelon, right? So watermelon, you might have it here and there right now. But even if they exist in the winter, are they going to taste the same as they do taste in the summer? They have that special taste in the summer, subhanAllah. But when you try them in the winter, they're not going to taste the same thing. Similarly, when you try to eat citrus fruits during the summer, they don't even taste the same thing as well. For Allah designed it on earth to be, you know, seasonal fruits. In Al-Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about it, أُكُلُهَا دَائِمٌ وَظِلُّهَا. أُكُلُهَا دَائِمٌ, which means that the ukul, the fruit is lasting. Means you will never run out of fruits. Never. You know, when you pick a fruit from the tree, is it going to grow right away in Al-Dunya? Of course not. We have a small tree of peaches outside over here in the masjid, mashallah. The only peach tree that we have here in the masjid. When the season comes, you're not going to get a chance even to try it when it's ripe. Why? Because mashallah, the kids will not wait. Every time they see one that is hit by color, they say, oh, there's a fruit, and they pick it, subhanAllah. And for you keep hiding one between the leaves, and someone says, maybe the kids are not going to see that one, inshallah, until it grows enough so you can try it. But unfortunately, it's unsuccessful. You wish that if someone picks that fruit, another one would grow after that. But that is only the quality of the fruits of Al-Jannah. You pick one, another one grows after it, right away. Doesn't wait. It's not like you have to wait for the whole season to come back. No. You pick one off the tree, subhanAllah, it grows right away, immediately. أُكُلُهَا دَائِمٌ. The food is perpetual. The food is always there. The second thing about the fruit of Al-Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفَاكِهَةٍ كَثِيرًا. So many. What do you mean so many? It means so many different kinds. So many different kinds. You know, when you go out, when you go to the food market, subhanAllah, and you see all the beautiful colors, wow, it's amazing. And then you want to buy, which one? This one or that one? Sometimes there are things I have never even seen before. Never tried before. So many things. Imagine in Al-Jannah. So it will be plenty and plenty of fruit. Some things that you perhaps, as the Prophet ﷺ said in Al-Jannah, which Allah subhanahu also mentioned in the Quran, فِيهَا مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطْرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. There is nothing you've ever seen before. Nothing you've ever heard before. It doesn't even cross your mind. What's there in Al-Jannah? The only thing you see in Al-Jannah from this world is just the names. To make it easy for you to comprehend, like when you say fruits. What does it look like? What does it taste? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. وفاكهة كثيرة. So special about this فاكهة, these fruits, لا مقطوعة ولا ممنوعة. What's the meaning of لا مقطوعة ولا ممنوعة? That means neither limited to season nor forbidden. You know, some fruits, you can't, it's forbidden for you. Why? Because it's too expensive. You might not be able to purchase this. Oh, subhanAllah, this is too expensive. Why bother paying that much money for this when it's something little or something? So eventually, Allah says here, لا مقطوع ولا ممنوع. It will never end by season, and also it will never cease to exist. Always available at your disposal. Something unique about these فواكه, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فيها, فيهما من كل فاكهة زوجان. They come in pairs. What does that exactly mean? Allahu a'lam. Two kinds. Fruits of two kinds. They always come in pairs. But what is it exactly? Does it mean like, you know, the apples when you have different colors? Does it mean we're talking about orange, for example, different kinds? What is it? Allahu ta'ala a'lam. But Allah says they will come always in pairs. Something that is very, very unique about the fruits of Al-Jannah. Another thing that is very unique about the fruits of Al-Jannah, Allah says, وَفَاكِهَةٍ مِمَّا يَتَخَيَّرُونَ. All what you desire. Whatever that you desire, you'll find it there. So some of us might say, how about strawberry? Are we going to find strawberry there in Al-Jannah, Jama'ah? Allah said, if you desire that, you'll get it. Okay, what about kiwi? Are we going to get kiwi in Al-Jannah? How about mango? Coconut? What else, Jama'ah? So are we going to get all of this in Al-Jannah? You might get it, but by names. And maybe shape. But taste, it'll be different. Now in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَحْمِ طَيْرٍ مِمَّا يَشْتَهُونَ. And the meat of fowl from whatever they desire. Means meat of birds. So all what they desire. Now what is so unique about this ayah? Some ulama, contemporary scholars actually, they point in something interesting about the etiquette of eating, the etiquette of diet in our time. Allah says over here, وَفَاكِهَةٍ مِمَّا يَتَخَيَّرُونَ. So he first started with what? With fruits, and then he spoke about meat. Today, when you guys eat, what do you eat first? Do you eat the main course or the fruit? We always eat the main course. And then we go for the fruit, right? If there's any space left for fruit. But the ayah mentioned the opposite. You start with the fruit first, and then you start with the meat. So it's a bit like saying appetizers. And then you come to the main course in Al-Jannah. So the fruit will be like an appetizer. So if you would like to resemble the fruits of the food of Al-Jannah, then always before you start your meal, always start with something, you know, maybe healthier, like fruits. Give it a try. Eat something like a banana, for example, or eat an apple before you start your meal. Could be healthier. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that for the people of Al-Jannah. Definitely for the dunya. We might have used, inshallah ta'ala, of that practice with Allah Azza wa Jal. Some of the examples Allah mentioned about Al-Jannah, the fruits of Al-Jannah, فِيهِمَا فَاكِهَةٌ وَنَخْلٌ وَرُمَّانٌ. I mean, the Arabs, one of the things that they desired the most, or at least they pride themselves with, and they kind of see it as a sign of wealth and sign of prosperity, is having lots and lots of palm trees. Which is true. If you've ever been actually in a palm tree garden, subhanAllah, the sight is amazing. It's amazing, unbelievable. Even when the Muslims, they went to Spain, the people, the Arabs, they took with them actually all their palm trees to Spain. In addition to that, even the architects of their masajid, like the very famous masjid of Qurtuba, the Qurtuba masjid, the entire design of the masjid, the whole arches, roofs of the masjid, designed as a garden of palm trees. So it's something that they always saw as a sign of prosperity, sign of wealth, sign of luxury. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, you're going to get it there. You will have lots and lots of palm trees. How do they look like? Allahu A'lam. And then he said, warumman. So you'll have fruits, you have palm trees, and you have rumman, pomegranates. What's so special about pomegranates? Now, other contemporary scholars of our time, they said, researchers, they found out that one of the qualities pomegranate is used for is used as an antioxidant, which is basically it helps to rejuvenate the cells and prevent the cells from dying. So if you always want to benefit, you know, from after eating a meal and so on, this would be very good and very healthy to again rejuvenate the cells in the body and prevent the dying of the cells. So that may be a reason to keep the life of the bodies of humans in al-Jannah perpetual by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the grace of Allah azza wa jal. The trees and the fruits of paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the fruits of paradise, قال وَأُتُوا بِهِ مُتَشَابِهَا وَأُتُوا بِهِ مُتَشَابِهَا and they were given them in the same likeness. What does that exactly mean? The ulama, they said tafsir, when people of al-Jannah, they ask for a special fruit, let's say you ask for apple, for example, you're going to be given apple. So when you eat it, it tastes nice, right? And then when you're given another apple, the ulama, they say, it doesn't taste the same. So even the taste changes continuously. How often? Every time it changes. So that the enjoyment, the instant moment of instant gratification, they're perpetual. You're always excited. You're always happy. There's always something that makes you excited and happy. Some of the ulama, even they said, it's not like every fruit, the fruit that you eat, it tastes different every time you eat it. No, they say every bite might even taste different. Imagine you're eating an apple, let's say, and then just take one bite, subhanAllah, it tastes like banana, ya akhi. And another bite, it tastes like orange. And then it tastes like this, it tastes like that, subhanAllah. And I remember a few months back, I was buying fresh gum, you know, at the airport. And then they have a new product that says this, basically, whenever you start chewing on that gum, it has multiple flavors. So every time you chew, a new flavor will be released. So you will have multiple tastes as you eat. So there is always an instant gratification moment as you chew that gum. And for me, when I looked at it and started trying it, subhanAllah, I said, wallahi, this description of the food of al-Jannah. Truly, when you chew it and you start having all these multiple tastes, it's amazing. And that's a description of the fruits of al-Jannah. Finally, inshallah ta'ala, Allah Azza wa Jalla says about al-Jannah, and last two slides, bin Allah, he says, إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ مَفَازَ حَدَائِقَ وَأَعْنَابَ. That is, they're not just going to come in fruits, they're going to come in gardens even. And these gardens, they're very unique in a way that is, they're all over the place. And the fruits, as the garden grow, the fruits grow with it all over the place. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want you even to worry about collecting that fruit. Why? Because the fruits are going to come your way. The fruits are going to come your way. So they're going to come very near your hands, and you will be able to capture and grab that food in your own hand. Imagine, even when you're resting on your bed, the fruit is going to come near your hand. You just pick it, another one's going to grow right away. And وَذُلِّلَتْ قُطُوفُهَا تَذْلِيلًا, make it actually very near to your hands. You request it, comes near you. You don't have to worry about actually walking for it at all. The Prophet ﷺ says, there is one tree in al-Jannah. There is one tree in al-Jannah to show how big these trees are. There is one tree in al-Jannah which the rider of a swift horse would need 100 years to pass beneath. Look how huge the trees and the gardens of al-Jannah will look like. So that you won't worry about, if you own few trees in al-Jannah like this, how big your land is going to be in al-Jannah, Jama'ah. Amazing, subhanAllah. So all what you need to do is just to work for it. All what you need to do is just making sure that you be there, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, to endure the delights and the pleasure of al-Jannah. There is more to talk about when it comes to the trees of al-Jannah, especially Sidrat al-Muntaha, which we will talk about, inshallah, next time we come, bi'nillah, Azza wa Jal. Next week, we're not going to have a class. It's many actually parents and families, they travel during the holiday season. So we're not going to have a class this coming Wednesday, inshallah, Azza wa Jal. But we'll resume after that, bi'nillahi, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Wallahu ta'ala alam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all from Ahlul Jannah. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us these houses, beautiful houses of al-Jannah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who will enjoy the delights of al-Jannah, the fruits of al-Jannah, the gardens of al-Jannah, and the beautiful water and rivers of al-Jannah. Allahumma ameen. Any question? Yes. So the hadith in Sunan Tirmidhi, in which the Prophet ﷺ, he described the people who will be the dwellers of these houses of al-Jannah. And he said, those who are lenient and kind in their speech, they feed the hungry, they fast continuously, they pray the night. Do you have to acquire all these four qualities to be qualified, or can I just focus on one and alhamdulillah would help me get into al-Jannah? Honestly, I hope that one quality, if you do it perfectly, that will qualify you to be in these houses of al-Jannah. There is no doubt having them four and all will be the best. But some of us, they cannot do Qiyamul Layl. But they can do fasting of every Monday and every Thursday. Some of us don't have the capacity to do that either. All what they can do is just give and be generous and feed the poor and the hungry and so on. So in which capacity you can, inshallah ta'ala, do, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide you bin Allah these houses of Al-Jannah. Allahu a'lam. Of course, there is no intoxication in Al-Jannah. It's coming, inshallah. We didn't talk about wines of Al-Jannah yet. We have a different session, inshallah. We talk about the delights in Al-Jannah. So there are so many, and we're going to talk specifically about that. The color of it, the kind of it, the taste of it, all that stuff, inshallah. Yes? You will have it, inshallah. Don't worry about it. Whatever that you desire, inshallah ta'ala, you'll get it there. It's not just fruits and chicken, yani. You'll have all kind of things. So don't worry about it. We just mentioned examples here. Now, yes, go. So in dunya, drinking wine is haram. So why was it allowed to drink in al-Jannah? You know, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave the believers the promise that if you protect yourself and not drink in the dunya, I'll reward you to drink that which is better than wine in the Jannah. So this is like a reward. And even in this culture here, when they speak about wine and drinking, what is it? It's a sign of chivalry, a sign of manhood, a sign of whatever that they call it basically. It's a cultural thing, social thing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bringing this as part of also the social culture of the people of al-Jannah as a special reward for them. So if you prevent yourself from consuming it in the dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you by giving it to you in al-Jannah as a reward. Wallahu a'lam. Yes? Are we going to be in the same body and the same flesh and so on? We covered that in a previous session actually in details. We're not going to be in the same, in these tiny details. The size of the body is going to be different. This body doesn't perish, so it has a special design. Death, of course, is already dead, so they're not going to die. The sense of pleasure is continuous, so the senses are always actually active in many, many ways. So Allah Ta'ala, I mean, how is it going to look like, at what level? But definitely the bodies are going to, they're going to experience the pleasure and the delights of Al-Jannah at a different level. Wallahu A'lam. Yes? What is saying? So if you acquire one house, okay. Of course, I mean if you maintain one of those four qualities regularly, and to acquire one of these houses, that's a guarantee that you're going to be in Al-Jannah. There is. And that's it? It seems that the hadith, the meaning of the hadith, that you maintain that. That you maintain praying the 12 rak'ah. When we say maintain that, doesn't mean every single day. But, you know, in most of your salawat, you don't intentionally miss these sunnahs. So if you maintain that, I ask Allah subhanahu to give you houses, not just one house. Wallahu a'lam. Now, what's your second question? You're going to get into Al-Jannah, inshallah ta'ala, and 12 rak'at every day, hopefully they will qualify you, inshallah, for many houses in Al-Jannah. Say ameen. Now, sisters, yes. What do you mean? I mean, how is it going to be erased, that good deed? When we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have basically to have to, before we even go into Al-Jannah, we're going to have to stop to try to reconcile with other people, right? You might come on the day of judgment with mountains of good deeds. But if you have spoken bad about this person, you were backbiting this person, you have made some injustice against this person, and they're going to start taking from your hasanat. All these hasanat that qualifies you to al-jannah, they're gone, right? So therefore, if you would like these hasanat that you're doing, if you would like these hasanat to qualify for al-jannah, you better be secure your investment. Yani. Secure investment. Don't make too many liabilities. You know, some people, they buy all these beautiful mansions, and then what? They have huge liabilities on themselves. So they have to pay this person and that person. They can't sustain the beauty of what they have. So you do the same thing for al-jannah. If you would like to acquire these houses, then do the work that will qualify you there, inshallah ta'ala, and secure your investment. Don't make too many liabilities against yourself. Wallahu a'lam. Khair, inshallah ta'ala. So again, next, you have a question? Go ahead, tafadhali. Lala, this is Sunnah al-Dhuhr. The four rak'ah that Habiba radiallahu ta'ala mentioned in the hadith, the four rak'ah before Salat al-Dhuhr, which means after the Adhan and before Salat al-Dhuhr. Naam. Wallahu ta'ala. Khair inshallah ta'ala. Next week, we're not having a session, but we'll have it the following week, bin Allah Azza wa Jal. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.